CC Rock, I'm Metal Matt, and hey, we have got a great show for you this time. We are out here in San Francisco. We are going to the Bone Studios for the Metal Zone with Billy Steele. Come with me, come on. This will be a really cool show because, you know, Billy is a cool guy. You know, he's one of my compadres in the world of media for, you know, hard rock, heavy metal. And we're just going to go and check out Billy and, you know, see how things are going. And, of course, be in the Metal Zone, promote CC Rock, and, of course, okay, this is a women's restroom. Let's try this way over here. This is, I know it's around here somewhere. We just got to find our way. Men's room, that's not going to be good either. Okay, I've got an elevator. Here's a door. Hello? I know Billy's looking for us, so we just gotta keep looking around here for him. Elevator, big metal door. Okay, that's not the way in. Let's go come with me this way. Let's go here. Maybe we can find our way through this maze. Okay. This way, hello? That's not the way, definitely not the way. That's not. Oh, here we go, let's try this over here. Hi!
Hey, may I help you?
I'm here to see Billy Steele. We're gonna be in the Metal Zone tonight.
Who are you?
I'm Metal Matt with CC Rock.
Sorry, sir, you're not on the list. What is all this?
We're doing a TV show, you know, Billy Steele, Metal Zone. You know, he wanted me to be on the show this week, you know, because I know he's excited about it, you know. It's really cool. Of course, we got Judas Priest on the show, too.
Well, maybe that's next week. I don't have you on the list.
Next week. Hey, Billy.
Sir, you got to stay back.
Well, can you go... Wait. You didn't tie your shoe there, buddy.
Yeah. I'll check. Yeah.
Okay, we're having a little problem. I'm sure it won't be that bad once he goes talk to Billy, because, you know, Metal Matt goes a long way in the world of rock and roll. So just hang loose. He'll be right back, and I'm sure he'll come on back. Come on, let's see. Where is he? Hello?
With CC Rock, we're backstage with a band. These guys, you could say the metal gods. I mean, they've been around a long time. They've done some amazing things in the world of metal. I've got KK Downing, Glenn Tipton, and the Ripper, Ripper Owens. Now, what should I call you, Ripper? The Ripper or Tim? I mean, Mr. Owens?
Mr. Ripper.
Mr. Ripper. Just don't rip one, okay?
Hey, don't tip me.
Don't
really?
Tip him.
Yeah.
We know who you are now, because it's a different world from my youth when there was a man named Rob Halford, obviously the leader of the group, and now you have come in and this group is kicking again. I mean, it was a little hiatus there for a little while, and now you're back with the Ripper. Tell me about this little story. I mean, I know a lot of people saw the movie Rockstar, and I know some people say, oh, Rockstar, something about Judas Priest, and, you know, what is your feeling? I mean, a lot of people out there don't know how you were found as this, you know, taking over Rob's seat in the singing position. How did that actually happen for the people out there who don't know?
Well, I was in a tribute band. I had an original band. We couldn't get any shows, and they said, you know, somebody said you should do a Judas Priest tribute band, because my band was real similar to that style, so... We did it, got paid a lot more and traveled around a lot more. And, you know, I quit the band, and about a year later I get a phone call, and it's Judas Priest on the phone. So it's kind of like, you know, the most amazing thing, I was the biggest fan, you know, and to get that phone call and to fly over there 2 days later and audition, sang one line, Victim of Changes, jet lagged, and they said, you got it? You got the gig just like that, you know, so it couldn't have been any easier.
Yeah, I mean, is this kind of like, I mean, I know you guys have, you know, the long history of Rob being all the way back to you guys when you guys were just, you know, pups in a sense, the world of heavy metal coming up and, you know, rock and roll days. I mean, what was that feeling? I mean, it must have been tough in a sense when he did kind of go in his own little separate directions, and then to find somebody to fit so nicely. I mean, what was the feeling when you did find Ripper?
I think, obviously, very, very relieved. We'd been looking for... considerable amount of time, years in fact, for the right guy, and by sheer coincidence, obviously, we saw a videotape of Ripper singing with his band, the tribute band, British Steel, and we just obviously wanted to be convinced that it wasn't overdubbed or, you know, he was miming or anything, and obviously, that's why when, like Ripper said, when he came over and he sang the first line, we knew that the whole tape was genuine, so... We're very, very relieved.
Well, like I said, I mean, most people out there know Rob Halford. I mean, growing up back in the 80s, I mean, to most people, he was the metal god as far as the singers. I mean, it must be big shoes to walk into, obviously. But, you know, enough about the past. Let's move into something really cool. That's Demolition, your new album. This is your second one, Ripper, working with the group.
Second studio record. We had a live one, Live Meltdown.
Oh, yeah.
Can't forget the Meltdown. So, what was the feeling like, I mean, going into the studio, working with Ripper? I mean, was it a fresh experience? I mean, what was it like?
He's just great to work with. His voice is so versatile, you know. And we couldn't have, you know, a better vocal tool to work with than the man here. You know, it makes life very simple. It's just, you know, we're getting along better than we've ever, we're playing better. It's great vibe.
Woo! Double dipping into the Saxon on a 3 for Madness weekend. This is the Metal Zone on 107.7 The Bone. My name is Billy Steele. In the studio with me, it's Metal Matt from CC Rock. And Matt, it's really cool that we get together, and it's kind of a coincidence that, here we go, just played 2 from Saxon. And wasn't it at the Edge in Palo Alto on the Unleash the Beast tour when Saxon played that we first met?
That was our first encounter, I must say. Unleash the Beast, the Edge, and that was a beautiful show. Of course, Biff's one of the best singers in the world of heavy metal and hard rock. But that was the first time you were actually on CC Rock, as you are right now on CC Rock right now, because we're taping a show.
By the way, yeah, I know. I'm so confused.
Isn't it confusing? Life is confusing.
There's cameras in the Bone studio, and I don't know. Everywhere I turn, I'm, you know.
Bright lights, big city.
Yeah, I can't even fart off camera tonight.
No, sir.
Or off camera, off
Don't
mic.
Pick your nose. And, you know, it's funny that Billy's wearing that pink fufu tonight. I don't understand it.
Yeah. Go to the Bone site, 1077thebone.com. Dispel the rumors.
Well, you know, Demolition, the new album, once again, Atlantic. It's a different sound, you could say, more than some of the... I mean, I guess on Painkiller, you could see kind of a change going on in Judas Priest as far as the sound-wise, the actual style of music. In the last two albums, it's been a little different as far as more... Maybe a little heavier, I guess you'd say. Not quite more the guitar riffs flying back, doing guitar solos. What was the change as far as... I mean, what was the actual aspect of why the change? I mean, who was it, somebody's call or just your feelings or what was going on?
You mean on Demolition or in general?
Jugulator, Demolition, the last two, and maybe a little bit of Painkiller even.
Doesn't have to evolve anything from the band, you know. Every album's got a place in the book of Judas Priest, really. It's a different chapter, but it's still inimitably Judas Priest, so we'll always change, you know. That's why we've been around for 30 years. Not drastically, but we've got to evolve, else we wouldn't be around today. But, you know, we could turn full circle, you know. We're constantly changing. We never give people exactly what they expect, and sometimes that hasn't always worked for us, the brave steps, but at the same time, it's no good to keep doing the same album with different lyrics, you know. So, and Demolition, Jugulator, Painkiller, they've all got their own character. British Steel, you know, Point of Entry, Turbo, every album's got its own character, but it's still Judas Priest. And
so continuous evolution, you could say.
Yeah, we've always been a band, I think, that's always pushed the boundaries of heavy metal in one way or another. Sometimes better, sometimes maybe not so better, but you know, I think that as Glenn says, we have to keep pushing forward just to see exactly what we can achieve. And the last two albums, I think, are definitely in your face, and it's the way to go.
Die!
Still here at the Bone in San Francisco. Hey, Billy Steele, you've been a DJ for a while now. Tell me a little bit about how you...
It's 1983!
1983, that's quite a ways back. And tell me, how did you get your start in radio? And how do you like being here?
Well, I love being here. I started back in 1983 at St. Mary's College in Moraga. You know, I didn't really participate in high school sports or do anything like that. And so when I got to college, I wanted to do something and get involved in something. So I chose a radio station, and never looked back. I knew once I did my first show that that's what I wanted to do.
Well, you got a lot of gizmos here. I mean, it looks like it's all going to hard drive as far as computers, radio.
Check it out. It's really cool. This screen right here, and I'll kind of bring it up for you and rotate it. This is what plays the music, and we're heading toward a commercial break. And basically, I'll hit a button on the board, and it'll go from commercial to commercial to commercial. I have to manually stop it, but I can. And all the music is in the system, except for, of course, the Metal Zone, which is played all on CDs. I brought them from home.
That's beautiful. In fact, you have your own little collection here, yet you still have the best of both worlds, technology, yet the little live selections over there and the free form of doing radio. I mean, I know that it's the way it's always done back in the old days, and now, of course, it's a little different. It's all mostly, you know, it's laid in and a lot of computers and stuff, but what do you actually like about, you know, the old days compared to the new days? Is there a choice?
Yeah, there's a choice. This is the coolest ever. I get to play whatever. I get to pick whatever. If you wanted to hear something like I did earlier, I was like, all right, what do you guys want to hear? What song do you want to, you know, play? And that's how the Metal Zone is done. It's done like the pioneers in classic rock did it. And it wasn't called classic rock. It was just FM freeform, you know, rock radio. And that's how this metal show's done. It's kind of cool that way.
Well, tell me about Larry. I know he's Larry Sharp has done a great job. Hey, okay, here we go. Yeah, I mean, it's the fact that he's put this great station together, all these great, you know, jocks, and you guys are doing a great job. Tell me about Larry. I mean, is he a cool guy to work with?
Well, let me tell you, everybody, you know, looks at me and says, you got the balls to play this type of music. Well, you know what? I got to hand it to my boss because I couldn't do this without him having faith in me making the right choices because basically he's out of the loop for these 2 hours of programming. You know, it's all about the audience and it's all about the metal. And I got to hand it to him because he's got enough balls to, you know, give me the rope to either hang myself or rock the world, you know.
So quite amazing. Well, back to Judas Priest, CC Rock. The song selection of your live show, it's something that's definitely I could say a little more intricate. I mean, you guys pull some things out that you haven't pulled out for a while. I mean, there's United, there's some stuff out there that, you know, like I said, these are songs that, while following you guys all the way from the 80s, I never saw much. Of course, I missed the British Steel tour. But like I said, a lot of stuff that hasn't been played for a while. Why the different song selection? Why picking certain songs, in a sense, as far as from different eras? Mostly older, it seems like.
Well, I think the big thing is they get to have an old fan that gets to help pick the songs now. So I get to say, here's what you haven't played, and I pick it. And honestly, United was one of them. I went into it saying, you know, let's try this, because, you know, what a great song, and a great song to play live, and I've never really heard it, you know, and I think that's what we try to do. Obviously, bring it back like Head Out to the Highway, which hasn't been, you know, in a set for who knows how long, you know, in Desert Plains, it hasn't been in a set for who knows how long, and, you know, just different songs like that. So I think we're trying to think of, it's really hard, what we're trying to think of songs that we could throw in. You know.
As you look at, you know, your new British Steel, the video, the DVD on Eagle Rock or Eagle something or other. But anyhow, tell me about that new DVD.
The British Steel, yeah. Well, obviously, that show's been running for some time, has it? No, so, you know.
It's a re-release, then, basically, then.
Yeah, and it was just a really cool thing to do. They approached us to do, obviously, the classic album, British Steel, and... And it was fairly easy and a lot of fun to put together, and I think it gives a great insight. Probably many of our most dedicated fans are probably unaware that we actually recorded the album in Ringo Starr's house in the studio, which was formerly John Lennon. So that surprises you too. It was John Lennon's house, you know, where he did the White album. Everything was white. So if anybody's seen the movie Imagine, that is the house where we recorded that so-called classic album.
Movie Rockstar, like I said, it's, you guys have seen it, obviously.
You haven't seen it.
I actually saw it on the plane coming over from the UK to Los Angeles. Coincidentally, it was on the was being shown on the plane.
And that's how you saw it. Coincidentally, it wasn't like you were actually going out to purposely see Rockstar.
No, it was just on the plane. It was on, you know, and so myself and Ian. So yeah, we watched it, but we kind of, you know, the consensus was between us that they must have cut some of the juicy bits out and some of the more exciting bits, mate.
The kids on the plane.
Family viewing.
We must have done something to the director in another life.
Oh, really?
Didn't show us too favourably.
It didn't.
We've distanced ourselves from the film only because, I'm not going to put the film down, only because it's not the true story in any way, shape or form. The only similar factor is tribute band to the real thing. And we thought if we got involved, they did ask us to write music for it, thought if we got involved it would fool people into thinking it was our story, and it isn't our story. So, and my 15-year-old son now thinks I take drugs every day, transvestites, and what else? Wear a wig.
So yeah, I mean, that's Hollywood, you know. You make your own movie, and
I didn't like it at all, really, because my character I've never ever landed on the planet of apes. You know, so really, I didn't like the movie.
Yeah. We thought that was just straying too far from
that
the truth.
That was going too far.
Yeah. Well,
Dirk over there, right? Dirk Diggler, is that your name? I'm sorry. No.
Like me.
Yeah,
I thought you were going to say so there. Yeah.
Damn, I forgot about Boogie.
That was a classic. That was a classic. Mm-hmm. back? I mean, now I know that you guys all, I mean, in a sense, I mean, KK, you have a relationship. Everybody's got a relationship somewhat with Rob here. I know that we were going to do an interview with you guys back in right before the 9/11 crisis that happened. And you guys were going to do a show in LA, and I heard this rumor that Rob was going to possibly be at the show or somewhere in the area, and you're maybe going to meet up and say hi. I mean, what is your guys' relationship with Rob? Is it you guys talk to him ever anymore? Or is it like, I mean, is there a relationship at all?
We speak, say hello, you know, sort of Happy New Year, and that's more or less it, really. Rob's obviously doing his own thing, and really, we haven't had really a minute to even think about our schedule, really. It's right there, it's always in front of our face. We've been out on the road now since early June last year. We'll be right back.